In our last lecture, we have derived what kernels are. We have put up the definition of kernels. We looked at certain properties of kernels. We also looked at the reproducing kernel Hilbert space that explains some of the theory behind kernels. And now we want to apply this framework to our first algorithm, namely to support vector machines. We now want to kernelize support vector machines. And to kernelize an algorithm means we first have the algorithm in a linear space, written in a linear way, such that we only need the scalar products between the points. Then we replace the scalar products by kernels, and then get the algorithm in this reproducing kernel Hilbert space as we have defined it in the last lecture. Let's now look at how this works. In the case of support vector machines, we start with the dual problem. Remember, when we derived the support vector machine, we first of all started with this geometric motivation that we want to maximize the margin between the hyperplane and the training points. We then wrote up what was the optimization problem. It was a quadratic problem. And then we used the Lagrange approach to derive what is called the dual problem of the support vector machine. And this is now the problem we want to start with. So consider the dual problem. And as we have already discussed when we looked at it, in this dual problem, the only way in which the training points affect the solution of the problem or enter the optimization problem is in terms of a scalar product. So they never occur alone. I never would need the coordinates of my points. I only need the scalar product between two such training points. Now, kernelizing means we take whenever we have an expression like this, the scalar product between two training points, for example, in our expression of the optimization problem, we replace it simply by the kernel version, kernel between xi and xj. Let's look at how this works. So here is the dual support vector machine problem. So we're given the input training points x, I, y, I for 1 to n. And we are also given a kernel function. The optimization problem is now essentially what you have seen on the slide previously when we derived the dual support vector machine problem. Just that previously, we had at this point, we had the scalar product xi, xy, xi, xj, sorry. And now we have kernel xi, xj. Now we simply plug in the kernel, and this is the kernelized support vector machine problem. We can solve this problem, and then we get the dual variables alpha. What kernel you use, this really depends on your application. As we said before, the kernel is supposed to encode some similarity between your data points. If you're in a Euclidean space, it could simply be the Gaussian kernel. Or if you want to classify people in a network, we said it could be like in a graph, you could say you use the graph kernel, whatever fits to your application. Once we solve the optimization problem, we now need to be able to compute what is the result of the problem on a new test point. And again, remember, we had this expression where we derived, once you solved the dual problem, how do the primal variables look like? Because we need these variables w and b to compute what is the solution of the support vector machine given to a new test point. And if you remember, the formulas looked like this. W was given a sum of alpha I, y I, x I, where alpha I are the dual variables, the ones that we found in our dual optimization problem, the one that involves the kernel now. X I are the training points, y I are the training labels. And we also derived an expression for b, which is a bit more complicated. So this offset parameter for the hyperplane, you first of all have to find some data point j such that this expression here is true, that cn is strictly greater than alpha I and strictly greater than zero. Alpha I, remember, is the dual variable. C is the trade-off constant of the support vector machine, and n is the number of training points we have. And then once you have such a point, you can compute b by plugging it into this formula. And so the label for a new test point is then given by simply using the hyperplane equation. We apply wx plus b for our new point x, and then the result, we look at the result and take the sign, and this is the new label we give to this test point. You can, of course, now express all of this in kernel language, where we now replace the scalar products at every particular place by kernels. So here, observe in the first line, maybe, we have a scalar product between training point xi and test point x. Everything is inside the scalar product, but because of linearity, we can pull out the sum and the alpha I and the y I. These are just real numbers. They are coefficients that we can take out. And then we're left with some alpha I y I scalar product x I x, and we replace the scalar product by this kernel expression here. And similarly here at the end of the formula. And now what you can see is that once you solve the dual problem and you have the alpha i's, and of course you know what your kernel function is, then you can compute also the labels of a new test point. This is typically how the support vector machine is used in practice. Now, why is this kernel approach so powerful? It's really, I'm going to come to that later again, but it is the approach that made support vector machines really successful and gave a breakthrough to the whole field of machine learning in principle. Why is it so successful? To explain this, I want to look at one particular example, the Gaussian kernel. So what we have seen is that this decision function of the kernel SVM has this particular form. Where I think instead of beta I, probably one would like to have alpha I. Let me just go back. Why did I use beta? I don't know. I think this should be alpha I here. I need to check that. So the decision case, the decision function, is a linear combination of kernel functions. So here we have a sum, we have coefficients, and then we have these kernel values. And they give us what the result of the function is on the test point x. Now, let's simply plug in. If k is a Gaussian kernel, it's just a linear combination of Gauss kernels, where sigma is here the kernel width of the parameter. We have already discussed it. It tells you how wide the Gaussian curve is that you're currently looking at. So all the functions that we can learn have this particular form. And now, why is this something successful? If you now consider an arbitrary continuous function in your space, and here I just plotted it for a one-dimensional case, then it is a fact that you can approximate such a function by a linear combination of such Gauss functions. And here I tried to show that. So the green function, this is really a one-dimensional case. The green function I might want to approximate is a complicated function. It's not convex. It doesn't have any nice properties beyond being continuous. And now I can approximate this function by a sum, maybe of these kind of functions here. So if I take these little Gaussian bumps that I have just plotted underneath, and I take the sum of all these Gaussian bumps, then what I get is something that is really, really close to this green function. And you can prove mathematically that it's always true that no matter which continuous function you take, you can always approximate it by a potentially long linear combination of Gauss functions. And this means, in practice, that whatever your decision surface might be in your original space, you would be able to approximate this by a Gaussian curve. And if you remember the figure we've always drawn when we had this, maybe I just draw it once more, just to recap. So the figure was, we have this complicated space X where our data comes from. It doesn't have any particular structure. We have data points in this space. And we might want to classify these data points by a function that is really something nonlinear. Typically, the decision function is still continuous, as I've drawn it here. But beyond that, we don't make any big assumptions. And then what we did is we did this whole kernel approach. We did this mapping to the feature space, where hopefully this function results in something that's linearly separable, because the space has such a high dimension, namely the number of data points, that it's highly likely that we can, or at least in many cases, we would be able to separate the data points. And then we did sort of evaluated the kernel, the scalar product in this space, and we replaced this by our kernel function k. What I want to show you is this linear function here that we have in the input space, this red function here. This is a function that can, for example, if we live in a Euclidean space, we might be able to approximate it with the sum of Gaussian functions. And I have some examples here on this slide where you can see how this works. So there are lots of these interfaces, Java interfaces online, where you can play with them. You put in some points, you choose a kernel width, you choose some sigma, and then the interface shows you how the support vector machine solution would look like. And here you can see that, so we have the training points, which have different colors. They're white and blue. And you see the decision surface, it's this white line here. And then yellow and blue. These colors mean it's one class or the other class. And what you can see here, the support vector machine can really realize very complicated function. Now, of course, it depends on the choice of parameters and in particular also on the choice of the kernel width sigma. So if sigma is really, really large, your Gaussian functions are very large as well, and then maybe you cannot approximate any function with just few Gauss functions. If it's very small, you are able to approximate many things. So maybe let me show this again in a plot on the iPad. So here is a coordinate system. Again, assume we're in a one-dimensional case and say the function we want to approximate looks like this. And now I want to show you two cases, maybe one where we have Gaussians with a very, very large kernel width. So maybe the Gaussians we have these kind of shape. You can already see on this plot that we might not, I mean, if you have many, many, many such curves, we might still again be able to approximate this red function with many of these blue functions with different weights. But if we have, say, just 10 such functions, it's not so likely that we can approximate this red function by the blue functions, by some of the blue functions. In this case, the parameter sigma, which gives us the width of the Gaussian, has been chosen much too large. What we observe then is essentially underfitting. We have a high bias and we cannot really approximate the solution very well. The other thing, the other extreme case, maybe I try to, I don't know whether that works, whether I can erase these blue curves. Oh, perfect. And do it once more with other curves. So now assume we have Gaussians which are very, have a very narrow kernel width. In principle, with these Gaussians, I can more or less approximate everything if I have enough such blue curves. To the extreme case that in this case I might even be overfitting. Observe, maybe also one more thing to note here when I do these plots, typically the Gaussians that I plot here, they need to be centered at training points because our solution k of x has the form, it is a sum of alpha I k of x I x. So x is the test point and x i's are the training points. So all these little Gaussians are centered around training points. So maybe this is our point x1, this is our point x2, this is our point x5, and so on. And so this trade-off between sigma tells, the choice of sigma is somehow tells us how fine-grained functions we want to look at. And if you look at, and this is why I started this whole discussion, at the plot on the slides, of course, depending on how you choose sigma, you might be able to realize very complicated decision surfaces or only very not so complicated, smoother decision surfaces, which give sort of smaller variations along the space. But if you're interested in this, maybe just try to search for some Java applet that gives you, I mean, there are millions online. Just type Java applet support vector machine, you will find some immediately that can show you where you can sort of visualize these kind of things and play with the parameters. I have already mentioned this before, but just to make sure, kernels like this Gaussian kernel are called universal kernels because they have this property that you can approximate any continuous functions with a linear combination of such kernels up to arbitrary precision. And the Gaussian kernel is such a kernel, this is why it is so powerful. The downside of this universality condition, of course, means that we are in a huge function space, in principle. Because observe, we can approximate any continuous function. So no matter how complicated our function is, and you have seen complicated functions maybe also on my laptop, on my iPad right now, we might be able to realize all of them using linear combinations of Gauss kernels. And this means that if we don't regularize, we might be prone to overfitting because our function space is all continuous functions and this might be too large. So all the more important it is that our algorithm does regularize, and the regularization in the support vector machine happens indirectly in terms of the margin. And if you remember how this works, so in the primal linear SVM problem, what we said is we wanted to maximize the margin, and then we said the size of the margin is essentially what is giving us the regularization term in our optimization problem. So what we said is in the primal problem, it leads to a regularizer of norm of W squared in RD. So this is the 2 norm in RD. Now, let's look at what is the regularization term if we now have our kernelized version of the algorithm. So the loss function didn't change because the loss function is still the sum of the parameters xi I in the optimization problem, sort of by how much we walk inside the margin or even to the wrong side of the margin. At this term, we didn't change anything, so the loss function didn't change. It is still the hinge loss. But the regularizer is changed because, I mean, it is still, remember we, go again back to this figure we had in the beginning. So I'm again in the top figure on my iPad where I show the kernel approach. The regularization happens now in this space because this is where we apply the linear algorithm. And in this linear algorithm, we regularize by the norm in this particular space. And this is now the norm in the reproducing kernel Hilbert space. It is not the norm in the original space. The original space is this one here, and it might not even have any norm. Sometimes it has, if we start with RD, but if we start with a set of molecules, it does not have any norm. So the regularizer is now the norm in the feature space. And now, how does this look like? How can we... This is again very abstract, like regularizing in the stupid Hilbert space, so you don't really get a good feeling. So what does it really mean? You can now spell it out. So if you write out, you know what the formulation for W is. W is this linear combination of input points. And phi of xi is the feature mapping of the point xi. So this is formally the norm of W in this Hilbert space, because by phi we went into this Hilbert space. And if you now spell it out, you get essentially, you can take out the sums and the beta I, beta j's out of the sum, and what you get is essentially this expression here. Maybe I simply show it on the iPad because it's here. So we have the scalar product of sum over I, beta I, phi of x I, sum over j, beta j, phi of x j. And now because of the linearity, I can write sum over I, sum over j, beta I, beta j, scalar product, phi of xi, phi of xj. And now because of the kernel framework, I can replace the scalar product. So this is now the kernel between xi and xj. And now if you write this again in matrix formulation, this is a quadratic form and it is exactly beta transpose K beta, where K is the kernel matrix that has all the particular kernel values as entry. So this is what the regularization term is now in our Hilbert space. So we regularize. So the statement is now when we are looking for a good solution in our reproducing kernel Hilbert space, we regularize, and the expression that we try to get as small as possible is beta transpose K beta. So we have this kernel matrix here, which implicitly acts as or enters our regularization term. Now, of course, it is not so easy to get any intuition on what that does. So, and in particular, what the geometric notion is. So what is a function? Like if I give you the space of all continuous functions or all, say, all linear combinations of kernel functions, and I ask you which one is a function that has a small regularization term, so which one is a function for which this beta transpose k beta would be very small, at least I would have a hard time to answer that right away because I don't have any geometric interpretation of what that really means. So I can't give you an intuition, at least for me, it is really hard to look at a kernel function and say, okay, this is a regularizer that I might prefer and this is one I might not prefer. So this is, for me, is too complicated. So the way I think about this is simply, this mechanism is a mechanism by which we restrict our function space. And the smaller this term gets, the smaller is the function space from which we pick our solution. And this is why regularization gives us something useful out. I don't have any better explanation for what it means geometrically. And I also think that there might be some people out there, but it's at least nothing that is known in the literature or that people could would know how to argue about. Like if I give you two kernel functions and you would say geometrically which one of the two functions has a better behavior, this would be hard to argue. There are some arguments. You can look at the spectrum of this kernel matrix and then make some statements about this, but this is again much more implicit again, so it's not like you can say geometrically this is something like a margin or this is something else. So you have it's more implicit. This slide here, again, essentially repeats what I have already said. If we wouldn't have this regularization, the support vector machine couldn't work, because that function space is so large that without regularization we would hopelessly overfit. Now, assume you want to apply the support vector machine in practice, how would you proceed? Here on this slide is the vanilla approach. So the first thing that you need to do is you have your training data, you need to come up with a kernel. If your data lives in RD, you would probably start with a Gaussian kernel, and then you only need to fix what is the kernel width sigma. However, there are often also situations where this kernel doesn't work, and then you might need to have something else. And in particular, if your data is not Euclidean, you need to come up with your own kernel function. And this is sometimes easy because there are obvious things to do, or maybe there also already exist some kernels in the literature, for example, kernels on graphs. But there are other cases where this might not be the case, and then you need to design a kernel function. Once you have a kernel function, you train an SVM. And typically you would do this within a toolbox. You wouldn't, I mean, of course, you can also program everything from scratch, but eventually you are probably going to use a toolbox. And then what is really important is that you make sure this toolbox sets the parameters by cross-validation. So you have this parameter C, which is the trade-off parameter between the regularization term and the empirical risk. And if you use the Gaussian kernel, you also have the kernel with sigma, or many other kernels, for example, the graph kernel we have seen in the other lecture has a parameter k that tells us how large is the size of the neighborhood that we want to take into account. Most kernels have such a parameter. And you need to set these parameters by cross-validation. Some packages don't do that automatically. Some packages simply have a default choice and they say c equals 1 and sigma equals 5. This is our default choice. And of course, then it's not going to work on your problem. You really need to set these parameters by hand on your particular data, and you're going to use cross-validation to do that. Okay, and this is sort of the vanilla approach. Later on, we're also going to discuss that there are, of course, many, many more steps that you're supposed to do before you eventually can apply your support vector machine. So typically, you have to clean your data. You might have to normalize it. You might have to remove outliers. You might need to reduce the dimension. There are many, many steps that you might want to do before. So what is here on the slide is simply the vanilla approach to apply the SVM directly to your data. Now there's an interesting question, why we actually started with a dual version. Couldn't we simply have the primal version and derive a kernel algorithm from the primal version, the primal support vector machine problem? And maybe as an exercise, before I give the solution, you might want to think about it. So here on the slide, we have again the primal formulation of our problem, of the support vector machine. And the way I've written it here is already involving a feature map. So I assume we have this map, we have already done this mapping, we are like, that takes us from the original space into that feature space. So we are in a framework where we work in this feature space, and now you might want to derive a kernel version of this algorithm. And maybe before you continue watching the slides, you might want to think about for 5 minutes whether you think it is possible for this problem to kernelize it at all. Okay, I assume you stopped your video and thought about the question. The answer is, a priori, you cannot do that. Because, let's go back, the key feature is that we need to have the training points as inside a scalar product. I mean, this is true here, but the scalar product here needs to be with a vector W that lives in your feature space. So, if you don't know what this vector W is before, you will need to evaluate this this scalar product in the feature space, because how else should you do that? There is no way, rather than simply computing what the scalar product here is, there is no shortcut. Because W is not typically, it's not just an image of a training point, it is a complicated linear combination that lives in your feature space. So, a priori, there's no way in which we can do it. However, we can now again invoke the representer theorem. The representer theorem told us that if we have an optimization problem of such a form as we had it on the previous slide, then the solution vector can always be written as a linear combination of input points. And if you invoke this kind of theorem, then all of a sudden it works. because then what you can do is, for example, here in this term that we had in the optimization problem, instead of having a scalar product between W and phi of xj, you can now plug in the linear combination and then pull it out of the sum of the scalar product, and then you have all of a sudden the scalar product just between phi of xi and phi of xj. So you only need to know the scalar products between training points. And for this you can again use a kernel function. So here's the kernel function. You can replace it, and for this expression you're fine. Now, once you've done this, you need to go through your optimization problem and see whether you have more occurrences where this might be a problem. Now, this norm of W, of course, maybe I go back here. The norm of W also is, like, if you wouldn't have any features, like, if you want to solve this optimization problem, of course, you need to know what W is. Somehow you can't solve this problem without looking at W, and W lives in your Hilbert space directly, so it seems hard to replace that. Unless, again, you make the assumption that W is a linear combination of kernel functions. If you do that, then you can replace it again. So W, norm of W, is of course the scalar product of W with itself. And now you can replace that by plugging in this for W this formula and exploiting the kernel. You can again write this as beta I beta j k of xi xj. So in this sense, you can also kernelize the primal of the support vector machine if you want. And here is again the solution, how it looks like. Now, why are support vector machines so successful or so well known? And I think you need to understand that we need to go back a bit in the time when they've been invented. That was in the 1990s. And at that time, pattern recognition was still a reasonably young field. Before support vector machines, people had often used neural networks, old day neural networks. That's what I wrote on the slide. I don't know whether old day is an English word that you can use. What I mean is maybe old fashioned neural networks. So at that time, I mean, a lot of effort went into how do you exactly construct the architecture of your network. And then people, of course, also used backpropagation to optimize the network, but it didn't really work very well at the time because people didn't really have the computational power that we have now for GPUs. And also, you need to have lots and lots of tricks. And I mean, right now in deep learning, there are so many people working on deep learning, they have discovered many tricks. At these older days, neural network was something that only worked for specialists. If you were a specialist in neural network, then you were able to apply neural networks to your problem and get really good solutions. But if you were not a specialist in neural networks, it was very hard. So if someone in bioinformatics had a classification problem, they typically couldn't just sit down, design a neural network, optimize it, and get the solution. You would need to think about it for half a year or so. And now came support vector machines. And they are so simple. You just have these two parameters, C and maybe sigma. You plug it in, you press a button, it's a convex optimization problem. You always find the global optimum, so you're not going to get stuck in local optima and need to restart millions of times and tweak parameters and do lots of tricks. You simply press the button and you get the solution. And this is something that even people could do who are not experts in machine learning, but who are applied computer scientists, for example, in bioinformatics. And this is what made the support vector machine so successful. It was an approach that more or less everybody could use and get pretty good results for many, many problems that were out there. The other thing, support vector machines are also appealing from a conceptual side. So this is why many people also in theory like the support vector machines, because you can really prove under which conditions does it work. There's lots of stuff that we are also going to see some of it later in the lecture. You can prove generalization bounds, you can look at kernels and really prove properties like universality or other properties, which tell you, at least in ideal cases, these algorithms do work. So you can give mathematical proofs, for example, that a support vector machine is universally consistent. And this is then also appealing for theoreticians, because it means at least we know that under idealized circumstances the algorithm gives us good results, so why not try it on my problem? Whereas there might be other algorithms for which you can't prove anything and they're really hard to understand, and then you might trust them less. Nowadays, I often get the question, well, why do we still need support vector machines? They're deep networks. We simply use a deep network for our problem, and that's going to solve it. And the answer to this question is, yes, sometimes. So nowadays, of course, deep networks are very powerful. You have lots of computing resources, there are millions of tricks that are known, and there are many problems, in particular in everything that has to do with speech and images, where neural networks outperform whatever you could else do with other algorithms. However, neural networks need a lot of data. So you can't like, and in particular, if you think about, for example, a scientific application in bioinformatics, you have these 20 patients, and you have genetic evaluations of these 20 patients, and you now want to learn to classify whether such patients have cancer or not. If you just have 20 training points, you don't even need to start training a neural network. It has millions of parameters. It's not going to work. And in such cases, support vector machines are still a very, very important tool. And there are many other cases as well. The second thing is that from a theoretical point of view, neural networks are not really understood at all. I mean, there are many things that we do in neural networks that are completely counterintuitive. For example, neural networks are being trained until they overfit like hell. I mean, you train them until they have zero training error. And it's clear from also from what we've looked at in the beginning of the lecture that this is a massive overfitting. And only now, very slowly, there are some first results from the theory community that start explaining what goes on, why does it still work, why can it still generalize even if this neural network overfits. And there are many other properties of neural networks which are also undesirable, like robustness properties, for example. You have all these adversarial examples and so on, which I don't want to say that neural networks are bad. I just want to say there might be applications where you cannot afford something like that. For example, you have a safety critical application, you're flying a plane. I can't imagine currently that someone would write a control problem for a plane using a deep neural network, simply because we cannot trust it. We don't really know how it behaves. There are no theoretical guarantees whatsoever. We need, if you have something that is really critical, you need to know what you're doing. I mean, now the question is whether for driving a plane you might want to use machine learning at all. So maybe this is a bad example because I'm not sure I would trust a plane that has been programmed using an SVM, but I would trust it much more because for SVMs at least it's very well understood in principle what they do and what they don't do. So the bottom line here is there are SVMs, there are deep networks, and of course there are other algorithms as well, like probabilistic approaches, which I even haven't talked about. And all of them have their corners of problem or their set of problems on which they work well. And it is really important that you understand that you cannot solve all the problems of the world with deep networks. You need this other side of machine learning, which is also why you're supposed to attend this lecture. At least the machine learning master students need to attend this lecture on statistical learning and also the one on probabilistic learning. So to summarize, SVMs with kernel, so we are given the data points in a space and we need a kernel function, so this is in many applications the critical step to invent what is the kernel function. They solve a classification problem. By the kernel trick, we have this embedding of data points into this abstract feature space. The inductive principle, maybe think a bit back, is when we started to discuss what the support vector machine is supposed to be, we said we want to have a large margin. And this is still the principle that stands behind the support vector machines, also in the Hilbert space. In the end, we have a convex optimization problem that's really, really nice. We can solve it by some convex optimization. We are going to end up in the global optimum. It is, I mean, there are lots of important properties that people have looked at. There's the support vector machine property, representer theorem, and so on. And if you look at it in a kind of regularization interpretation, it corresponds to minimizing the hinge loss, and the regularization is the norm in the feature space. So, if there is one thing that you want to take home from this lecture, then use support vector machines as your prime example. So this is really the algorithm that is used in classification beyond neural networks and beyond probabilistic models. If you have want to solve a simple classification problem, you use an SVM, and this is likely going to succeed. Well, if your data contains some signal, the SVM is likely going to solve your problem.